Welcome to the VEX Robotics Competition referee training videos, designed for both referees and teams. This is Chapter 9, Protected Zones and Alliance Towers. While defense is allowed and a perfectly reasonable strategy in Tower Takeover, there are a few instances in which robots should not interact with their opponents. During the autonomous period, robots are not allowed to contact the foam tiles, towers, or cubes on the opposing alliance's side of the autonomous line. As you'll notice, there are some cubes and towers located in the middle of the field that begin the match in contact with the autonomous line. These are free to use by either alliance, but teams need to be cognizant of the possibility that opponent robots may attempt to do the same. Note that teams may have parts of their robot cross over the autonomous line during these interactions. This is perfectly legal, as long as the foam tile on the opposite side of the line is not touched, and as long as there is no intentional interaction with any opposing robots. Remember, the autonomous line is not a vertical plane. Next up are protected areas. Each alliance has one protected zone located in the corner of the field. This area is split into an outer protected zone and an inner protected zone. The outer protected zone is defined as the three-dimensional volume extending upwards from the foam tiles and bound by the field perimeter, the outer edge of the protected zone tape line, and the inner edge of the inner protected zone tape line. The inner protected zone is defined as the three-dimensional volume that extends upwards from the foam tiles and bound by the field perimeter and inner edge of the white tape line closest to each alliance's goal zone. In addition to the inner and outer protected zone, each alliance has their own specific alliance tower that only robots on that specific alliance are allowed to interact with. Under Rule SG3, robots may not intentionally or accidentally, directly or indirectly, perform any of the following actions. Contact an opponent robot, which is fully contained within their protected zone. Contact any scored cubes in either of the opposing alliance's goal zones. Contact any placed cubes in the opposing alliance tower. Contact either of the opposing alliance's goal zones or barriers. Minor occurrences of these actions that are not match affecting will result in a warning. Match affecting violations will result in a disqualification. Teams who receive multiple warnings may also be subject to disqualification at the head referee's discretion. In addition to the actions that were just listed, these next few actions will result in an automatic disqualification regardless of whether or not the interaction was match affecting. Contact with an opposing alliance's inner protected zone, causing scored cubes within the opponent's protected zone to no longer meet the definition of scored, that is to say, knock over their stack. Cause a cube which is placed in the opposing alliance tower to no longer meet the definition of placed, that is to say, remove it from the tower. These areas are protected for a reason. They are meant to protect an alliance's hard work that was put towards scoring their cubes. So, it's very important that teams are cognizant of their opponent's protected areas and try to avoid them at all costs. The two protected zones are on the side of the field that is right next to where the head referee is standing. This was intentional. Referees will need to watch these areas very closely and will need to be diligent about understanding these rules and their subtle differences. That's all for Chapter 9. Thanks for watching, and be sure to check out the other chapters in this referee training series, which discuss various specific refereeing topics.